Okay, now, as with all EMC and testing, there's a plethora of standards. The most complete standards are product standards, and those are the ones that you would go to first of all, because if your product comes under that category, it makes it somewhat more straightforward. Not simpler, but more straightforward. So, if the sort of things that you're manufacturing household appliances, you'll look at 55014. Lighting equipment, 015. If it's IT, it'll be 55022. Medical equipment, switchgear, measurement control, telecoms, radio. So those are all product standards, and they cover everything that needs to be tested. If you can't find a product standard, then the default is to go to the generic standards. Now, you only use those when you can't find the appropriate standard. And luckily, there's only four of those. They break down into the domestic and light industrial environment, which for emissions is Class B. And that's characterized, now not exclusively, but as a simple definition, if it's going into somewhere and supplied from a domestic main socket, the chances are it's going to be Class B. And that's for emissions, that's going to be 61,000-6-3. These are all 61,000s, I might add. And for immunity, it's going to be 6-1. If it's in the industrial environment, for emissions, that's Class A, and that's as a simple definition, it's not foolproof. That would be if you're into three-phase supply. And the emissions are covered by 6-4 and immunity 6-2. Now, quite the only reason I have these ones here is that quite often I still see declarations of conformity that refer to these obsolete standards, EN50081-1 and 82-2. There are actually four standards there because there's 81-2 and 82-1, four standards. They've been obsolete since 2004, that's 10 years ago. So any product that you buy that refers to those standards means that the company has been asleep for the last 10 years. And that would be a flag to say, you should maybe ask them why they have a defective declaration of conformity, because the declaration of conformity is not valid with either an out-of-date directive or out-of-date standards. And in fact, that's only the start of it, because there are defective standards. In the same way that Simon was talking about the toaster standard, we also have a somewhat defective standard in this 55014, which is the one that applies to domestic appliances. There was a prosecution to a product that had been correctly tested to that standard. It was a domestic appliance. That was the right standard, but it still caused interference. Trading standards drew the attention of the supplier. It was manufactured in China, but the importer, his attention was drawn to the fact that it was causing interference, and he took the view that basically, I'll see you in court. So they did go to court. And the court ruled that compliance must be shown to the protection requirements of the EMC directive, not the particular standard. So, and as Simon has said, all standards now say that they give a presumption of conformity, but it is not a watertight guarantee. You can't rely on that alone. So, when you're buying equipment, and you all do, don't look at me with blank looks here, because you all buy equipment or components, and you should always get the declaration of conformity. before you've actually bought it. It's much easier then. And the as I had previously said, I don't make any apology for emphasizing this, because this is a very important point. If you've bought something and then request a declaration of conformity, best of luck, because they have no legal requirement to actually give it to you. If you make it a requirement before you buy it, 99% of the time you will actually get it. And those that won't supply it, then you know there's something wrong. There shouldn't be any problem. They can't market it, they can't put it on the market if there isn't a declaration of conformity. So if they can't find it, how would you find it? So when you get it, check that the declaration of conformity is to the correct standard, because as I was saying, a component or a piece of equipment could well be CE marked, but to which directive? You might think it's to the low voltage directive or the EMC directive. It could be to neither of those. Maybe it's the pressure equipment directive. You don't know. So check the directive. Check who signed it. I wouldn't worry too much about that particular one. Quite often on the web, you will get unsigned declarations of conformity. The legal declaration of conformity has to be signed, but they can put a copy on to the web that isn't signed. That is quite okay, in fact. The date is important, because the chances are, if it's older than 10 years, you would sort of worry, because the directive or the standard could well have changed. So when it comes down to testing, there's something like 12 tests, which I'll go through shortly. But I'm going to start with radiated emissions. And the this is the basic standard, 55022, or one of the basic standards. I mean, there's more. This specifies one of the ways that it can be tested. It can be tested at 10 metres or 5 metres or 3 metres. And these limits apply, and that's the frequency range there. They're different for Class A and Class B. And for Class A, you'll see that these limits are higher than the Class B ones. And the sort of equipment you need is an antenna linked by a cable to a spectrum analyzer or receiver. You'll have the equipment to be tested, which can be rotated in the room. This is a shielded room with absorber on the walls, the ceiling, but not necessarily the floor. And this is what I have. So these are receivers, which on their own are 30 grand. This is the shielded cabinet, and you can just see here that that's part of the absorber. There is an absorber beneath the walls and the ceiling. And because it's a semi-anechoic chamber, the floor actually has an absorber. And you can see that this is a computer that then puts up the emissions. And this is the sort of thing that you get. So this is the limit line running along here in red. This is the pre-scan from 30 megahertz up to 1 gigahertz. And you would sort of see, well, looks like it's failed. Has it actually failed at this stage? Any guesses? Anyone like to commit themselves? I know it's just after lunch and you'd like to slumber, but if I don't wake you up now, it's all over. Anyone like to hazard a guess? Has it failed? Very good, well spotted, yes. It hasn't failed yet, because this is a quasi-peak measure limit. The measurement that I did was peak, So it has to be averaged. Now you might say, well, why didn't they just do average? Well, it takes a long time to do quasi-peak averaging. It's a computationally intensive measurement to make. Oops. So the conventional mechanism is that you do a pre-scan, which just looks at the peaks, and then you go back and quasi-peak it later. So at this stage, it hasn't failed, but you would quasi-peak each or a representative number of peaks that are above the threshold. Now, for conducted emissions, you use a receiver, but this time there is a line impedance stabilization network. It doesn't have to be done in a shielded room, although I do it in a shielded room, but it's a different shielded room to the anechoic chamber. Now, this stabilizes the mains power coming in, and you will notice that there's no indication of where neutral is. The reason for that is it's just one power line and earth, because this is done per phase, and neutral is a phase as far as the LISN is concerned. And in fact, the measurement is made normally with live to earth, and then it's done neutral to earth. There are two separate bits in the LISN. And it's not a mistake, that's 8 microfarads. Now, when you work that out, and it's so it's 5 ohms, so you've got live coming in here through a small choke, and 8 microfarads through a 5 ohm resistor, and this is 1.2 microfarads with a 10 ohm resistor. And if you work that out, it's actually 0.8 of an amp per phase. So there's a lot of power diverted to earth, and that has the effect of cleaning up the mains. And then the actual signal which goes to the receiver is not well shown here, but it's basically, I certainly wouldn't want to connect my receiver straight into that. Mine has a matching network and a peak lopper to make sure that it doesn't damage the receiver, because you're dealing with mains here. Receivers are very sensitive and they're easily damaged. But potentially, you measure between this network here and Earth. And the limits, again, class A, higher limits, and there's two of them. There's quasi-peak and average. Average is different to quasi-peak, believe it or not. Quasi-peak is an averaging system, but it's a specific averaging system. Average is just arithmetic mean. And class B, basically, you have to, it's lower limit. So what does that look like in practice? Right, well, it looks more complicated than the radiated emissions one. This is the quasi-peak for quasi-peak limit. This is the average limit. And again, this is the pre-scan, and this is a new basic, this is the average one. Again, that's a pre-scan measurement because it has to be repeated again for both phases, and obviously quasi-peak. So that's emissions. Very specialized equipment. It's not general purpose stuff. It's got to be calibrated frequently. It's very expensive equipment, so I charge an absolute fortune to do it. Then we come to immunity. The equipment is a lot less expensive, but it's much more likely to damage your equipment. And there's three effects here, going up in terms of length of time that the effect lasts, and the power goes up. So this is electrostatic discharge, very fast rise time, less than a nanosecond, very little energy, It's millijoules. It's basically the amount of charge that you would have accumulated in your forearm if you walk across the room and you turboelectrically charge yourself under certain conditions. That's the sort of energy that would be produced when you get an ESD event to Earth. Electrical fast transients, around about 5 nanoseconds rise time, but this time it's 1 or 2 kilovolts as distinct from most standards for ESD only go to 8,000 volts, by the way. It's not a high voltage. For EFT, that's a couple of thousand volts. The peak current is a couple of amps, quite low. And then surge is much slower. It's microseconds rise time. Again, much the same range of kilovolts as electrical fast transients. The current is higher. And in fact, this can damage equipment frequently. And the waveforms look like this. ESD, ultra-fast, lasting a very short time and then a longer drop-off. EFT, bursts, and surge, a much longer time and a lot more energy potentially put in. Now, when immunity testing is done, you have to evaluate, well, has the equipment operated as expected or has it failed? And there are more criteria than these ones I've put up, but these are ones that are representative. You set the interference to the specified level in the standard and then see what happens. If it operates as intended, nothing, there's no degradation of performance, it's criteria A, so that's a pass. Criteria B is there is a degradation of performance, but it's within the allowed performance level. That would be a pass if it fits in with what the manufacturer specifies. And then C is where there's a temporary loss of function, which is recoverable normally by turning it off and back on again, or it might be that the communications dropped out. It has to be re-established manually. So there are something like 12 tests that a product might have to be subjected to. Generally, you find battery-powered equipment might only require 3, in fact. But if it's mains-powered, chances are it could be 12 tests. So radiated emissions over this frequency range, 27 megahertz to 1 gig. The basic standard is now up to 2.5 gigahertz. And in fact, the requirement for some standards is to go up to 5 times the highest clock frequency. So that could be up to 6 or even 12 gigahertz. Using a semi-anechoic chamber or an open area test site, they're not used much now. Obviously the antenna that I was talking about, turntable to rotate the equipment under test and a receiver to measure. Radiated immunity, 80 megahertz to 1 gig or now up to 2.5 gigs. Anechoic chamber, signal generator, a power amplifier, a field probe to measure, and a camera to monitor what's happening. Electrostatic discharge up to 8,000 volts. That's stepped up in sequence, and there's 2 types. There's contact discharge, and there's air discharge. Power frequency magnetic field is only done if there is likely to be a susceptibility to that. Conducted emissions using a line impedance stabilization network and a receiver. Conducted emissions using a clamp and receiver. I didn't show you how that was done, but it's much of a muchness as to the conducted one with the LISN. Harmonics and flicker, which is looking at harmonics are current fluctuations. Flicker is voltage fluctuations, which is imposed on the mains. And to do that, you need a stabilized main source and then the analyzer. And again, there are limits for particular products. Conducted immunity on mains and signal cables. That's where you put electrical fast transients and surge conducted capacitively coupled onto mains and signal cables. Electrical fast transients, those are capacitively coupled. Surge 1 to 2,000 volts, and voltage dips, that's the dips, interruptions and variations are where the instead of having a nice stabilized main supply, you deliberately introduce imperfections into the mains and your equipment still has to function. And last one, bulk current injection, where using a current probe, you inject from 150 kilohertz to 80 or 100 megahertz, depending on the particular standard. So 12 tests, you can imagine it can take quite a lot of time. And for something that is a new design, there's actually very little chance of it going through all 12 of those tests.
Yeah.
So, you should always have a test plan. And that's because basically, if you don't have a test plan, as Winston Churchill says, you're going to miss the target. He who fails to plan is planning to fail. It's a vital part of when you're designing a new product, and it should have confidence testing, maybe a couple of hours initially, to look at effects that are most likely to cause problems, and then retesting after you've hopefully rectified problems. And what are these problems? Well, first thing is the test standards are no help at all to get compliance. They just tell you how to do the tests. There's very little guidance in them to how to fix problems or how to design it in the first place to avoid the problems. The standards change quite frequently. All the equipment that I was showing you there, you don't get that in a normal test lab. It is very strange, very expensive, and easily damaged. And you won't get consistent results unless the person doing the tests has been trained and the equipment is calibrated. So, something like over 90% of what I test fail. Now, the good news is it can be rectified sometimes as simply as add-on components such as ferrite clamps, capacitors and inductors, surge arresters. None of those components cost more than 50p. If you're unfortunate, you might have to fit something like this, which is a couple of pounds. You would be rather unfortunate. And you can just imagine you've made a nice compact control panel and then you've got to put three of these in. Not good news. And those are some of the optional components that I was talking about, where you fit an inverter drive and it says maybe you need to fit line chokes. Well, you can get bigger line chokes than that, but you may well have to fit. So it might, in component cost, it could well be less than a pound. I can remember one product I tested, in fact I've had a few, where they've left with 13 of my ferrite clamps. So that cost £13. But of course, it's £13 multiplied by all your production. It can mount up. Or it could take months of testing and a total redesign, which thankfully has only happened a few times. 30% of CE mark products already on the market are found to be non-compliant when tested. And in fact, I find this all the time. And in some cases, it's because it was tested to the wrong standard, or the test house didn't really understand what they should have been testing it for. Or it could well be that the manufacturer didn't expect you to use it in the way that you have used it. So there are reasons for non-compliance. Wires act like aerials. One of the articles that I've put on the USB stick makes a very good point that if you think of shielding, earthing and filtering, so that's on your USB stick, have a look at that. It's full of common sense points that if every new product you make, if you consider shielding, earthing and filtering right at the start, you can avoid a lot of the common problems. The point about that is that you can have a noisy source, but if it has no way of getting out of the cabinet, then it's not going to be a problem. Linear power supplies constructed from the simplest way I can remember. Our standard power supply was I would buy a transformer, get a bridge rectifier, put a capacitor. So that's the simplest that it could ever be. No one does that now. Well, just as well, because in fact, something as simple as that can give rise to all sorts of problems. And certainly you'll probably get susceptibility to voltage drops, dips. And unfortunately, the same applies to CE certified power supplies. Now, I fail these regularly, 50% in fact. These are the plug-in power supplies. I fail a whole load of these. Half fail when I put them on just resistors. So what that means is that they shouldn't be in the market. What I find is that the temptation to buy cheap power supplies overrules all common sense. But for something like a quarter of the instances, it's actually your load that's causing the problem, and it's actually not the power supply. You might have thought that a plastic case will solve all your ESD problems, because obviously if it's plastic, you can't get an ESD event into it. Well, you're wrong, because if there's any metal, you know, like screws in the case, that will allow an ESD event in, and you'll get mini strikes internally in the plastic. And metal cases don't solve all radiated problems, because you're probably thinking, those that make control panels, that you shouldn't have any problems because it's surrounded in steel. However, your cabinets have got slots and holes when you bring cables in, and you've got slots when you close the door, so you've got gaps. And radio waves have zero width. So if you give them a slot, it can be a very tiny slot, like the size of a human hair. But you give it a nice long slot, you'll get a huge amount of emission from that. I've got a recommendation later. If EMC performance is really necessary, you will have to buy a properly constructed EMC cabinet. And then, of course, you get design conflicts between EMC and the low voltage directive. Simon has already referred to that in filters. You may get good EMC performance from a filter, but it may get lead to problems in terms of the low voltage directive. And again, I've found this quite frequently. The semiconductor manufacturer, when you're buying chips, they may specify use a split power plane for safety compliance. Well, good luck if you do that, because you will inevitably get EMC problems. If you only concentrate on satisfying one directive, the chances are you will run into these conflicts. So, zinc-plated back plates, I think they're more or less the norm now. Some factories had the specification that back plates should be painted in certain colours. It's a very bad idea. If you must have to conform to that specification, you've got to remove the paint around the mounting holes of the components that you're putting on, or use serrated washers. And if it's important in how wires are terminated, you've got to make that plain to the wire assembler. And earthing wires must be as short and as wide as possible if you want to have any sort of EMC performance from them. And a standard control panel enclosure has gaps and insulating seals. So if you want EMC performance, you've got to pay the what I call the EMC sucker surcharge. The increase in cost is something like 30 to 50%. But if that's what you need, that's what you're going to have to buy. And you've also got to specify EMC glands on your cable entries. And remember, screen cables only work effectively when they're earthed at both ends. And if you can't do that, then if it's signal cable, you can use specialist high common mode rejection equipment, or fiber optic cable would be the best, in fact. And in any control panel, you will have high emission pieces of equipment like inverter drives, servo drives, those sort of things. Keep them well away, and their cables well away from maybe instrument amplifiers, which could well be affected. And it's easy for me to say it, but those optional components that manufacturers specify them, if you don't fit them, then the chances are you won't comply. There's no point bringing it to me to get a fail note, because you just get a big bill from me then. And motor cable has to be screened with a 360 degree earthing clips. You may have to fit ferrites if that is specified by the manufacturer. You might not, but if they say to fit them, you will have to fit them. And again, if they specify EMC glands, you've got to fit those too.